the first session of the second day. This is the art track. We have four talks here. The first one is On the Depth of Oblivious Parallel Worm by Hubel Chang, Kaimin Chorn, Elaine C, and Hubel is the speaker.
Thanks for the introduction. So in this talk, we're going to investigate the depth of Oblivious Parallel Worm. So, I have lots of things to cover, so let's just start from the basics. So what is an ORAM? An ORAM, essentially, is a very useful construct. There's a POP that is secure. We can think of that as the CPU or the client, in which it has some constant-size secret memory. And then, there's a part of the larger memory that is untrusted. Usually, it's maybe the hard disk or maybe the server. So the adversary can observe what's going on here, and then this part here is secure. Now, there's this untrusted part. Unfortunately, if you want to secure the data there, using just encryption is not enough. So that's an example of why that's true. Suppose I'm going to store some sensitive medical data on some server, and if I do not use anything special, if I just say this part is related breast cancer, this is related to liver, and this is related to kidney, then even though they're encrypted, if the client somehow when they access this database, if you see that the client is accessing this part very frequently, then you can infer that maybe this client is looking up something related to kidney. So if you just use the encryption, if the layout of the memory is naive, that means you sequentially lay them out. If the adversary can somehow know that which part you are storing, which kind of data, that will have an issue with privacy invasion. So this ORAM is actually I have been studying for a while. So abstract speaking, so there are some, let's say, logical addresses. Essentially, ORAM is used to implement the data structure like an array. So there's some logical address. And typically, it's indexing from 0 to n minus 1. And let's say you have some storage on the server. To store this data, this long array, want to emulate this RAM. So the storage on the server, there's all the n storage, and that's not secure in the sense that the adversary can observe which part of the server you're accessing. But then the content of the each block, we say that the unit data of access is a block. On the server, the content of the block cannot be observed, but then the person can see, let's say in this example, which location on the server you can access. So a more powerful adversary can actually distinguish whether you are doing read-only or write, but let's say that's a minor technical detail. So what does it mean by ORAM is secure? So this notion is introduced in about 20 years ago. So essentially, if you have two request sequences of equal length, then what the adversary observe, the access pattern on the server, should be indistinguishable. So of course, if you have a very short access sequence and a very long access sequence, you cannot hope to be able to obfuscate it too. Otherwise, the short program would be very inefficient. So the ORAM notion is only to be secure against when you have two request sequences of equal length, and the adversary, when observe the access pattern on the server, then cannot decide which world you are in. So there are two notions of security. So statistical security basically is that if you use randomness in your implementation of the ORAM, then the distribution of the access pattern should be exactly the same for those two sequences. That's statistical security. For computational security, we only need to be efficient against, secure against polynomial adversary. For example, you are allowed to use PRF, sugar random function, in the design of the ORAM. And there's this notion of failure. Here, failure is not it's not security failure. The failure means maybe when I shuffle blocks around on the server, some blocks might be lost. So obviously, I want the failure probability to be small. So in this talk, the ORAM will have some very small failure probability. That means some blocks might actually get lost. Alright, so that's the sequential version, has been studied actually for a while. And in this talk, actually we're doing the parallel version. That means there's more than one client. Maybe you can imagine that many researchers are trying to access this database. And the notion of security is similar. So the adversary should not be able to distinguish batch sequences. So if there are, let's say, n clients, so at each time step, they're going to issue n such requests, the adversary cannot actually distinguish whether they are accessing the same site or maybe different sites. So actually, when you think of it, it's quite difficult. You have to make sure that even if the two clients have some collision on the same, they're actually accessing the same data, the adversary actually should not be able to tell this. So that's been challenging. So this notion is introduced like a couple of years ago, actually. So in this model, let's say there are n clients, and then let's say at each time step they are requesting a logical block. So it's like the parallel version of the ORM. We can think of how many is interesting. Let's say n is around root n. Let's say that would be an interesting case. And the underlying PRAM, we can assume that the clients, they are allowed to, of course, do concurrent read. And let's say if they do concurrent write, there's some underlying rule to resolve the conflict. But let's say when we implement this PRAM using the Oblivious version, we are most restrictive, we do exclusive write. So actually this is the best sort of configuration. When you try to implement something that allows concurrent write with something that only you exclusive write. So we can think of this as the abstraction, and then the output operand is the actual implementation, Oblivious implementation. Alright, so what is a good implementation? There's some performance metrics. So those are the old metrics that have been considered before. So the what's total bandwidth or total work is, if you think about the original model PRAM, each CPU, if you lay out the memory using the naive way, to access a block, just need a constant, let's say I/O, constant transfer of blocks. If you want to do it obliviously, then you might have to pretend to access blocks you don't need or shuffle blocks around on the server. That would introduce extra number of accesses. So the blow up is defined as the, let's say, the total number of blocks accessed by the those CPUs divided by n, because when there are n CPUs, then the naive way just to access all the n blocks. So the blow up will be the total number of blocks accessed in each time step divided by n. So that's the bandwidth blow up. Now we're doing a parallel PRAM. So what is the parallel runtime? It's the number of round trips using MCPUs. So let's say for the old metric, you have MCPU in the PRAM, in the abstraction, and in the implementation, you also allow MCPU. So that's the parallel runtime. And previously, actually, there are two main ORAM approaches, which both can be generalized to the parallel version. So that's the hierarchical framework. That's quite old. And I wouldn't have too much time to go into it, but just understand that each of these array represents like a hash function. So a hash function, and you have to use a sugar random function in this approach. So you achieve computational security using the hierarchical approach. And then there's the tree-based approach, which is discovered like a bit later. And in this approach, typically we can achieve a statistical security. So we don't need a pseudo-random function in the tree-based approach. All right, so what's the best result for ORAM? That is a sequential version. So for the best blow up achieved by the hierarchical ORAM is this log square n over log log n. And for tree-based ORAM, this is for like general block size, means actually at least log n, because you need to somehow at least be able to store the key. So for block size at least log n bits, that's the blow up. And for tree-based ORAM, if you need to have this general block size, the blow up actually is log square n. But if the block size is really large, that means it can store maybe so many bits, then the blow up of the bandwidth is actually log n. This actually matches the lower bound. Alright. Now, what about the prefix results for OpRamp? When OpRamp, the parallel version, was first introduced, they have these blow up, and we can see that actually this doesn't match the performance of the sequential version. So very recently, actually I was involved in both projects. For tree-based ORM, the blow-up actually matches exactly the sequential version, and later on, in this same session, my other co-author will talk about this. Alright, so now we have the matching performance of the best sequential ORM. So what is this work about? So this work is about another performance metric, the depth on the parallel algorithm. So when you think about it, since there are MCPUs implementing this Oblivious PRM, and this is actually inherently a parallel algorithm, and in the literature of parallel algorithm, there's this concept that if you allow more CPUs in the implementation, then what is actually the number of parallel steps? And in the algorithm, sometimes you can represent using like that, which indicates a data dependency, and in such a representation, the depth simply is the number of layers in your graph. So that actually represents the minimum number of parallel steps required if you have actually unlimited amount of CPU in your implementation. So we're going to investigate if you're going to implement an Oblivious RAM, then what is the depth of the implementation? Alright, so in this paper, we have several interesting results. So we show that for statistically secure OpRamp, the total workload up is same as before, like sequential version, and also the just the OpRamp version. And but the depth we can get something like log n over log n. And then if it's computationally secure, we also have a variation, but we don't have too much time to talk about this. And then if the block size is really large, then what's interesting is that we actually get quite small depth, log n, but we actually blow up the size by a little bit. So before for large block size, we only have log n, but in order to decrease the depth, we see actually we have to suffer slightly in the total work blow up. So that's the result, upper bound result. You observe that there's actually a log n term here, and actually it's necessary. It's because that we want to obfuscate in each time step whether the n clients are accessing the same block or they're accessing very different blocks. So I'll talk about why actually this will cause a lower bound on the depth. Alright, so those are the highlights, and then I just have some not too much time to tell you like what are the things to look for if you're going to read this paper. So there's some technical little bit of, let's say three things that I want you to, as a take-home message. Alright, so the first thing is that we're using tree-based ORM. So if it's the first time you see it, of course, then you can only get a very brief idea. So for tree-based ORM, you have this batch, which is reading something apart on the tree ORM. And then this part, the ORM is actually not modified, so it can be easily made parallel. And there's this maintain phase, in which you remove the block you just read, update it, and put it back. So actually, somehow non-trivial to make it parallel, but it's actually in a previous paper. So what actually you need to understand tree-based ORM to understand what I'm going to talk next is that in tree-based ORM, there's an invariant that in this tree, given a logical block, you'll have some position map which is contains the leaf. And the invariant is that this block must be found on the path from the root to that leaf. And whenever the block is accessed, the next time it will get mapped to a different random leaf. Now the issue is that if you can store this position map on the client side, then it's good. What if you cannot store it because the block size, we only have one block of memory, so the client can only store limited amount of information. Then you have to store this part, the position map, recursively, like this. Now you can see why this is bad for the depth, because in order to access things on the topmost level, you somehow have to sequentially get data between adjacent recursion depths, recursion levels. So you can see if the depth is deep, then somehow each level will incur some depth, and then the total depth will be d times the depth incurred at each level. Now, naively, if you do it like this, the intuition is that when you route between two levels, there are n results fetched between this level and then n requests another level. And in order to maintain oblivious, this routing between adjacent level has to be oblivious. And that will actually incur log n. Another source of the depth is actually, when you read a path, the length of a path is actually log n. And to read something useful, there's only one thing that can be useful on the path. That will automatically take depth log n. So this part somehow is not avoidable, but this paper we're trying to avoid this log n. So the smart idea is that we're going to do the offline and online routing trick. So the trick is that to compute this oblivious routing, we need somehow log n depth. But fortunately, this log n depth can be done offline in parallel over all the d recursion levels. The reason is that even though we don't have the information, if we pretend that at the moment we have the information, we can already build up some kind of random routing permutation. So this part, even though it takes depth log m, it can be done in parallel across the d recursion levels. Now when the actual routing happens, you have the information required, then we can do the routing. But at this point, the random permutation is reduced to adversary. It is okay because the permutation looks uniformly at random. So then this is a trick so that we don't need to suffer log m at each recursion level, and instead we just have log n. So that's the first idea. The second is actually for the maintain phase. If you are familiar with path ORM or circuit ORM, then the maintain phase needs to deal with a linear scan on a path of length log n. So naively, to do so, it will take log n depth. And then here we use a very smart divide and conquer way. Well, the details in the paper, but the conclusion is that we can reduce the depth from this to log n, but we have to increase the total work slot. So that's the cost of having a low depth. Okay, so that's for the two things I just talked about is related to the upper bound. Now for the lower bound, then you can ask, why is there this log m, intuitively, why should there be a log m depth? So remember that we have to make sure the oblivious property to satisfy the condition that if you have n concurrent requests, then the adversary should not know whether the n concurrent requests, where they are, as in distinct blocks or the same blocks. Actually, in general, they need to hide actually the partition induced by the addresses. So what's mean by partition? Imagine if you have five people, they might be all doing distinct queries, then they are each in the equivalence class. Maybe those two of them are accessing actually the same block, and then those two are the same, and then this is actually accessing another block. So you can see that depending on the addresses they are accessing, this will cause them to be partitioned into different equivalence classes. So the oblivious RAM, oblivious op-RAM, need to actually hide this partition. So in order to do so, we have actually in the paper some combinatorial argument to show that because of this, the depth has to be log n. So of course the details are a little bit complicated, so we wouldn't have too much time to go into that. But let's say there are some three things in this talk you should get a message. First, the two is related to upper bound. In order to reduce the depth, then we have all these recursion level. The trick is that the work you do, maybe there's an offline portion and an online portion. The offline portion can be done in parallel so that it doesn't cause the depth to deteriorate. So that's the first idea. Second idea is that in the path detection algorithm, then I use divide and conquer so that I avoid just a linear scan on the path to reduce the depth. And then the third thing is about the complete oral argument to argue that the law bound on the depth, because I need to hide how the M requests are partitioned. So those are the three main points in this paper. And of course, there's an open question that is there further trade-off between like the total work and the depth? Because right now I have just have like this somehow seems to be a trade-off, and it would be interesting if I can also have a lower bound on the trade-off. All right, so thank you. That's my presentation.
Questions?
Nice work.
Thank you.
I have a question. In your work, does you differ the read SSR and the write SSR Unicode SS?
So in the definition, the adversary should not be able to distinguish read and write accesses. But in the implementation, the adversary can actually see whether the block you're accessing is read only or write. But in some, actually, it's not too relevant if it's a sequential ORAM, because if you want to just read something on the server, you can just read it, re-encrypt it, and put it back. So even read-only for the sequential, if there's only one CPU, it's not a huge problem because you can always re-encrypt. But if you're in your implementation have multiple CPU, then you have to be careful, because when they're actually doing concurrent read, then you cannot use the re-encryption trick. So when there are multiple CPUs, then you have to be more careful whether the in the implementation is really just read-only, or you actually, if they're both concurrent write, then because in our implementation we won't allow concurrent write, it has to somehow be resolved by the algorithm upfront to decide which CPU is actually going to write the physical block on the server.
Thank you.
Other questions?
This is the R track. I'm wondering, in a real implementation, how many CPUs are you thinking of?
Well, to be theoretically interesting, has to be something like with N, but like depends actually on the application. Typically, would very log N CPUs. If the N block, I'm not sure. Do we have any idea?
The step thing is like, if you have, let's say, ample supply of CPUs, like what is the minimal sequential amount of work you have to do? So in practice, if you have fewer number, you can always like simulate one CPU with multiple CPUs. Just depending on how many resources you have. Like if it's like an SGX cluster, you can easily have, 100 machine SGX cluster, in which case you have 10 different CPUs.
Other questions? Okay, let's thank the speaker again.